This is the original IBM Personal Computer model 5150. This is actually the first revision of it, so-called Revision A, which dates from its introduction in 1981 until early 1982, when IBM made some updates and changes to the PC. The Revision A is notable because it only has up to 64 kilobytes of memory on the motherboard. And even if you use an expansion card to add additional memory, it can only support a maximum of 544 kilobytes of RAM, as opposed to 640 kilobytes of RAM that was the maximum for the later revision. It also has an earlier BIOS version, which does not directly support the use of hard drives or an EGA or VGA video card, because they can't initialize the BIOS used by those cards. So you can only support booting from a floppy. There were some aftermarket hard drives available for these early PCs, but they still required the use of a boot disk in order to load the driver for the hard drive. This one is equipped with 256K total memory using an expansion card, a monochrome text display and printer port adapter, and two double-sided floppy drives. The very first PCs only had single-sided floppy drives, but these are double-sided for a maximum capacity of 360 kilobytes on each disk. I have the original PC keyboard here, the nice clicky buckling spring keyboard. I do not have the original IBM monitor for it, and this is actually a color monitor, although it is a multi-system monitor which can support anything from the original MDA monochrome all the way up to Super VGA, and it even has a composite video input on the back. It's a Mitsubishi Diamond Scan 1381 monitor, so it is a color monitor, although this only has a monochrome display adapter installed. You can see on the back all the different input jacks and switches for the different modes this monitor can support. There's the BNC jack for composite, and a strange 25-pin input for color RGB, which of course requires a special cable, and a 9-pin connector for TTL, which is either CGA or monochrome. And the monitor itself was made in June 1988, so it's quite a bit newer than the computer itself. Of course, there's the cassette port, which the original PC had, and five slots instead of the later eight slots that the PC XT had. Okay, let's fire it up. First, turn on the monitor. Let it warm up for a couple seconds here. And then we'll flip the switch, which is over on the side here. This PC has an extremely quiet fan in its power supply. You can hardly hear it at all. That error is something to do with the memory, which I have to check out once I open the case. It's probably detecting a bad RAM chip somewhere. But it does boot into cassette basic there. See, it's original version 1.00. The later PCs had version 1.1. This MDA uses a 50Hz refresh rate, which is not agreeing with the camcorder too well, so you may see some flickering. There's also a little basic program you can type to display the BIOS date of the system. So I'll run it here. And this has the original 10/1981 BIOS. That's 1981, whereas the Revision B has a BIOS date of 1982. I have this book here, which originally came for Personal Computer XT, but it's close enough that the software that it came with will work just fine on the original PC. So let's pull out this disk here. Exploring the IBM Personal Computer version 1.00, copyright 1983 to 1984. Stick it in the drive there. Now I'll hit Control Delete to boot it up. It starts loading from the floppy drive. And it goes through a whole series of lessons here about using the keyboard, using the disk drives, using DOS, and using BASIC. But there's one kind of fun thing in here is a imitation word processor called FunWriter, which I'll show you a little bit of later. One notable thing about the MDA text adapter is that it can support underlined text, which the CGA and EGA and even VGA display adapters could not do. You can see some more underlining there. And part of its lesson about the keyboard here. Here's FunWriter, the imitation word processor. And they can do some pretty interesting stuff, which I'll show you here. Here's the PC with the cover removed, and this lets you see some of the other things that distinguished early Revision A PC. Of course, it says right there 16 to 64K CPU, because this supports only a maximum of 64K on the motherboard. Another difference, especially on the very early ones, is that the Intel 8088 chip is dated only 1978. In 1981, Intel released a new revision of the chip which corrected some problems it had, and eventually those newer chips were of course included in PCs, but the very early PCs only had the 78 revision. And in fact, when you bought a math coprocessor which would go in this socket, IBM gave you an updated 8088 chip to solve that problem. They said it was matched to the math coprocessor, but that wasn't really true. They just wanted to help get people to have the newer CPU chip to prevent any problems that might occur because of this older revision and some of the bugs it contained. But this one never had the math coprocessor installed, so it still has the older CPU chip in there. And you can also see that the backplates are painted black and they're wider. Now, when the PC XT was introduced in 1983, it had 8 slots, and the slots were also slightly narrower in width, so these wider covers and backplates would no longer fit. So IBM switched to slightly narrower silver backplates, but this is the older PC made before then, so it has the wider black ones. And also, the power supply is the original black-colored 65-watt version. I think in the later PCs, IBM used the same 130-watt silver-colored power supply that the XT had. But this is the original, and I believe the power supply fan runs off the 120-volt AC line, which is another difference. These had a reputation for dying because it just didn't have enough power capacities to support upgrades such as a hard drive. I also noticed that the second floppy drive does not have the IBM logo on it, but if you look inside, it clearly has a sticker which says IBM Corporation. So it's definitely an IBM specification drive, it just doesn't have the logo on the front. This is the only part of the computer that is not an original IBM component. It is a quad RAM memory expansion board designed to expand the memory from the 64K that's on the motherboard to a total of 256K. And this is also the only repair I needed to do to the whole computer. It's this one chip here. You can see it's a different brand than the rest. The original chips on this board were all Texas Instruments, and I replaced it with this one here because this one chip was bad and it was causing a memory error when I turned on the computer. But with that one chip replaced, now everything works perfectly. And you can see this is also an early product designed before the XT came out, because it has that same wider black backplate on it. And it's just designed to go like that, right on top of one of the existing backplates. So there's the quad RAM board installed and ready to go. But before I put the cover back on, I'm going to do some preventative maintenance and clean the floppy drive heads, which is very easy to do on these old full-height drives. You just remove these two Phillips screws, unplug these two connectors, and then the circuit board lifts up and out of the way, and you get full access to the drive heads to clean them. And also, while I'm at it, I'm going to lubricate the drive rails. And as proof that those three cards have been in the same position for a long time, they match up to the dust marks on the inside of the cover. On the back, there are a few other differences which distinguished early Revision A PCs. The most notable being that the case is only held on by two screws at the bottom sides. The later Revision B PC, as well as the XT, had an additional three screws at the top, at the sides, and at the middle, which this one lacks. And I don't know if IBM ever officially called this the Revision A, but the later PCs with those updates had a letter B stamped in a circle on the back right about here. So people have taken to calling those the Revision B since they have the letter B stamped on them. And if that's B, then this must be A. This one happens to be serial number 262697. I have here DOS 2.1, which came with an amusingly cartoonish manual. Don't normally see these kind of cartoon characters in IBM manuals. And these disks have faded over the years. The labels, they weren't always this pink. So here we go with the power up. I have a backup copy of the PCDOS 2.1 system disk. Put that in the A drive, and we flip the switch. The fan is very quiet on this PC. Just turn down the brightness a little bit for the camera. On the original PC, it does not display the memory count on the screen as it's testing the memory. So all you get is a blinking cursor as it checks the 256K of memory. Any moment now, there it goes. Starting up DOS. Asking for the date. Today is April 9th, 2012. Time is around 8:35 p.m. And there it is, PCDOS 2.10. Just get a directory. And there you have it. We can run the original sample programs that came with the PC. And most of these will require the color graphics card, but there are a few we can run. For example, the music program. There's various little tunes it can play through the PC speaker. It's rather primitive, but you have to remember this was a business computer, and back in 1981, most of those didn't even have any sound at all, just a little buzzer. So the ability to do even this kind of music was pretty good for the time. Okay, we can escape out of that. Now, even if only a monochrome text display, it is possible to run some games, especially those that were designed early in the life of the PC, when not everybody had a color monitor yet. This is a pretty good version of Pac-Man. All in text mode. Oops, got me. I was looking at the camera instead of at the screen. Now they're not chasing after me when I want them to. Okay, come here. Gotcha. So this is actually a very good version of Pac-Man. Plays about as good as you could ever expect it to. And it was made in May 1982, around the same time as this computer was. Well, just as that was a clone of Pac-Man, this is a clone of Tetris called Niet. Oops, I wanted to get that one all the way over. Good, I got a tall one there. Those are always the best ones to get, those tall ones. I can even do that same trick where he displays the next piece. So, pretty good clone of Tetris. Pretty easy so far. Though I think I chose the lowest speed. So, once it gets going faster, of course, it'll get a lot more difficult. Now this is where I start leaving gaps in the thing down there. Yep, so let's just end that. My name is IBM PC.